Hi there, my name is David Andolfatto, and I'm with the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis in the Research Division. We're here at the 40th Annual Fall Policy Conference. And today I have the pleasure of speaking to Fatih Guvenen, who's of the University of Minnesota. Fatih gave a talk yesterday on a paper called Use It or Lose It, Efficiency Gains from Wealth Taxation. Welcome, Fatih, and thank you very much for agreeing to sit down and talk about your paper here. So
thank you.
Why don't you just tell us, what do you mean by use it or lose it and wealth taxes?
Sure. So if we just look at some broad numbers on how much the United States government is collecting in taxes on capital, the numbers are astounding. It's about 8% of the GDP. So at a gross domestic product of $15 trillion, the total amount is $1.2 trillion per year. So effectively, the government is taking this enormously large chunk of money and using it for various purposes. Now, there's a good reason why, you know, we need this money, because there are government expenditures, but the sheer size tells us that we should be extremely careful in how actually we are taxing the different components of wealth. So by that, I mean, we are raising, as the government, a lot of money from capital gains taxation, from corporate income taxes, from taxes on dividend and various other sources of capital. The main thesis of our paper is that there is a more efficient way of doing this. And the key idea is that we should be taxing the stock of wealth rather than the income that results from that wealth. So let me give you an example. Imagine there are two investors with the same income, or the same wealth rather, and one earns no return on this because he or she is not a great investor. And the second individual is a great investor, so earns, say, 50% return per year on this wealth. The current system is taxing entirely the successful individual and raising the funds from that individual alone. And because the first individual is not earning, the wealth is there, but the returns are low, we are not collecting any from that individual. And what we are proposing rather is to actually look at the wealth that you own and tax that stock. In this example, the first individual, even though he or she is not a great investor, has a lot of wealth. So we would be taxing the stock, reducing the wealth of the inefficient individuals.
I see. So the paper is not really a paper advocating wealth taxes per se. You simply point out that the taxation of capital income presently in the United States is large. It's a large mm-hmm. component. How much of total tax revenue comes from capital income taxation?
It's about 27%.
So that's a sizable fraction, yes, of total tax revenue, almost a third, yes, from capital income taxation. You're not taking a stand on the size of that, but rather the composition of what components of
exactly
that wealth should be taxed. And you're suggesting, if I understand you, not to tax the necessarily the income component, but more the stock, a wealth
the
tax.
The stock, yes.
So let me see now. Now, why might that be the case? So, you mentioned that your prescription here relies on kind of what I detected a hidden assumption, mm-hmm, or maybe it's not hidden. You made it explicit that some people are better than others at investing.
Yes,
that's surely the case. Mm-hmm. I think also in your talk you mentioned the distinction between Mark Cuban and Elon Musk.
Yes. What is called a serial entrepreneur.
A serial entrepreneur.
Because he founded PayPal, then yeah, he sold it, then he started, you know.
So he keeps on coming up with these great ideas. He's got these great,
exactly,
these other people perhaps go into philanthropic activities, mm-hmm, or whatever. But, I mean, shouldn't it be the case that the low return guy should allocate their wealth, perhaps through the banking sector, to those that are better able to use it?
True. So some of that is happening, but imagine that you are a very high return individual like Elon Musk.
Okay.
What are your incentives to share that high return with somebody who just has the money. So if you think about how the funds flow mm-hmm. in the economy through intermediation,
yes.
is that if I have a high return, I will go and I will try to borrow, yes. for example, as a company in the bond market.
Yes.
So there's this well-known fact in financial economics that if a corporation issues a stock, mm-hmm. an equity, the market views that as bad news.
Okay.
And the idea is that if, as the insiders, I think that I have a great project, high future returns, I will not issue a share of that profit to you.
Right.
Instead, I will issue a bond. So okay. issuing bond is viewed as good news. Okay. So because it shows that I trust my returns, I want to keep it. So in the example that you gave, yes, there will be funds flowing, but the low return individual will never get the high return of the investor.
Okay, not quite the high return, but of course, Cuban could invest in the bonds that Musk issues,
Absolutely.
And they would be a higher return than
kind of
now. It's just not the highest return associated
sure.
with the equity finance.
Sure. So I can give you a few examples, mm-hmm. though. If you had the foresight to buy the Apple stock in 1980 mm-hmm. at the IPO price, mm-hmm. Between 1980 and 2015, you would have earned an average annual return of 20% mm-hmm. for every year in these 35 years. If you look at some very successful hedge fund managers, mm-hmm. Like David Tepper, mm-hmm. who is a billionaire, his average return, again, is estimated to be 20%. Mm-hmm. If you compound that, mm-hmm. the Apple stock has the value of the Apple Corporation has gone up 400-fold. So this is far above what the U.S. stock market pays on average. And even it's incomparable to what the bond market pays. So there are these huge differences across the returns that individuals get. And there's some evidence that these are very persistent over time.
So maybe this is related to my comment I'm about to make. But, you know, you're picking the cherries here, and the winners. Of course, the winners are making these huge returns. But
sure.
you're suggesting these funds flow to kind of, we don't know who's going to win beforehand.
Sure. But that's precisely the idea, yeah. that wealth taxes, the way they work is, yeah. we show this mathematically,
okay.
that even if you don't know who is going to win what, mm-hmm. if you tax this is a very robust result. We can prove mm-hmm. that in our framework, if you impose wealth taxes without knowing who earns what, mm-hmm. It will select automatically going forward those who have a high return. They will keep that high return, and those who have low return will automatically actually be pushed down.
So the wealth tax then is primarily concentrating, it's taking the appropriations out of the wealth and not the income.
Yes.
So this is the sense in which it constitutes a relative subsidy to the high productivity?
Absolutely. So the way I describe it is, yeah. it's a wealth redistribution from the non-productive wealthy uh-huh. to the productive wealthy.
Okay.
So you are reallocating, because if you look at the data, you see a lot of children of very successful entrepreneurs inheriting billions of dollars, but then they have other ambitions. And so some of them give to philanthropic causes, which is fantastic. But at the same time, you might wonder, well, if I give that to a startup with great ideas, we are not literally transferring it, but mm-hmm. the system does this automatically mm-hmm. by lowering the tax rate on the startups and young entrepreneurs and taxing instead individuals with huge wealth and no return.
I see. Okay. So I think I'm understanding this. Mm-hmm. So the way we're speaking here is as if the policy is actually appropriating funds from the less productive.
Yes.
and reallocating it to the more productive, but that's not what's happening directly.
Mm-hmm.
The simple point is, listen, the government wishes to collect some revenues through taxing capital. What's the best way to do this? We can tax capital income.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, higher capital income is indicative of higher skill, so we're
yes.
penalizing skilled entrepreneurs.
Absolutely.
And as opposed to, say, somebody who just owns wealth that earns zero return,
yes.
they would escape a capital income
yes.
tax because they generate zero capital income.
Absolutely.
And so that's a sense in which we're penalizing the productive entrepreneurs and subsidizing the not so productive. You're recommending, well, let's share the burden more equitably
Absolutely.
In some sense, and at the same time promote this increase the after-tax return on
capital.
Is that basically it?
Yes. So I can give you, if you will, like an example that applies very well to developing countries.
Okay.
And I'm from Turkey, and Turkey being one example, where when I grew up, the wealthiest individuals in my town were farmers, very large farmers owning like 10,000 acres of land. But that's as we know, it's a very low productivity business, but you have so much capital, in this case land, that you can make a very good living out of that. In the 1990s, Turkey and my town in particular switched to textiles, and these are factories, manufacturing, much higher returns, especially in the 90s. And a lot of these farmers did not have the right skill to switch into textiles. So in this example I give, you have a slow growing sector like farming, a new technology arrives that grows much faster, capital income taxation will actually collect all the taxes from the small but very productive textiles and leave untouched the farmers.
Right.
Whereas wealth taxes will say, wait a second, the one who is more productive, the return will fall much less because the tax base will be extended to the farmers.
So essentially we're just arguing for a more efficient form of wealth capital taxation here.
Absolutely.
And you build a formal mathematical model to try to estimate kind of the gains to such a switch.
Yes.
Do you find that your model estimates that the gains are potentially large? Or under the, could you identify the circumstances where they may be large or small?
Yes. So by comparable estimates of different policies that economists have studied, what if we reduce capital income taxes, increase labor income taxes? There is a large literature in public finance in macroeconomics studying this. By comparing to the numbers in those literatures, yes, the potential welfare gains are quite large. One interesting feature of the change, if we were to change today from capital income taxes to wealth taxes,
kind of a revenue neutral kind
yes,
of
in a revenue neutral way.
Yes.
The government keeps the same revenue,
okay,
but the economy will adjust such that on average there will be less need to accumulate wealth in the economy. So the overall, what we call the wealth to output ratio or the wealth to GDP ratio will fall by about 10%.
Wow.
And the reason that you can do that is because the capital will be allocated to the more productive individuals. So overall, we will have to hold less wealth, but output will go up, wages will go up, and welfare will go up. Again, all of it is coming from removing this misallocation of capital to low productivity individuals. So many policies that are recommended by economists, they pay off in the long run, like what we call the steady state. You change the rules of the game, you change the tax law. After 10, 20 years, you reach a new kind of plateau where things look better. But oftentimes, along the transition path, along those 10, 20 years, there will be some suffering. You will, you will have to accumulate capital. You will have to consume less. In the policy we are studying, it's the opposite actually, because you will move from a high wealth economy to a low wealth economy, so you can dis-save along the way and still produce more.
So we could finance a consumption boom along this. So higher material living standards for everybody, as we deplete our wealth. We don't need as much wealth because it's going to be allocated in a more efficient manner.
That's the key idea.
And actually our incomes will generally be higher, real wages.
And even those who don't have wealth benefit from this because wages go up.
Are you currently advising any governments?
I'm not.
In terms of like the practical considerations of tax collection, is there any reason to believe that collecting a wealth tax might be more difficult than taxing capital income at its source? I mean, would it be, I'm an idle rich person. I have this account that's currently sitting somewhere. I'm a U.S. citizen, let's suppose, but it's very easy to switch citizenship, I suppose, or perhaps move the account offshore. I don't know how it works, but
sure.
Capital income, though, is generated domestically. You have to file income tax, I'm wondering, as a practical matter, kind of the possibility of avoiding the wealth tax. I mean,
I think there are two separate issues, and you raised one of them, which is that, you know, if we start taxing wealth, the low productivity wealth, you might want to shift your wealth. That particular issue applies equally well to capital income, because if, you know, you look at the numbers, Gabriel Zucman has a very nice paper about tax havens, and which just came out a few months ago, and we do see individuals actually having their hedge funds or their investment accounts to be in Bermuda, in Grand Cayman, in some other places. In that regard, I frankly don't find it to be too different.
Okay.
There's a separate issue, which is the the reporting and actually documenting the wealth. That, if anything, it might be easier than what we currently have, because currently, you know, at the end of the year, Vanguard or Fidelity, these, you know, brokerage houses, they send to the IRS every single transaction on our investment accounts. If I sell a stock, is it like a short-term gain, long-term gain? What's the cost basis? So that system is already in place. And so rather than taxing the income that accrues and looking at every single transaction, you can just look at the total wealth that you have. Wealth taxes have also been implemented in about more than 15 OECD countries over the past century. So some countries actually started in the 1920s and have taxed throughout the century. Norway is an example, Sweden is an example, France is an example. But what when you look at the actual reasons they tax, you know, why do you do this? There's always an argument about equity. But there hasn't been an argument or a theoretical quantitative study that shows you can actually have efficiency improvements from this, which is the contribution
that's,
that we make.
That's the interesting part of this, and the fact that you find that the gains are potentially large.
Yes.
That's kind of interesting. And in terms of, if I understand correctly, the redistribution that occurs sounds like it might occur at the upper level.
It does.
So this is not necessarily...
It does very much so.
Yeah.
If you look at the numbers, the top 1% holds about half of the stock market, both directly and through mutual funds, and they also pay a very large fraction of individual income taxes. The estimates range from 35% to about 40%. So. Yes, this change will be mostly a redistribution within the very rich, and we hope in the right direction from an efficiency perspective. But the rest of the population, they will be positively impacted through the productivity gains and higher wages.
Okay. I should have asked this earlier. When you say wealth, I mean, exactly how is it measured, say, in your model, and how would it be measured in reality if such a policy, the wealth taxes that are applied to, in particular, does it apply to, most people kind of lower down in the wealth distribution hold most of their wealth in the form of housing.
Yes.
Does your model say something about the type of wealth? I mean, should it be, people's equity in their homes be taxed?
Sure.
Or are you talking about something else like financial wealth?
We always have to be careful when we map a model into the data for, the reasons that you just raised. My personal view, partly, influenced by our study, is that we are not talking about really housing wealth. We are talking about, capital that can that can produce goods and services.
Okay.
So,
housing produces goods and services.
It does. So, I actually wanted to trying to put that carefully. It produces services just for the owner, whereas if you're a factory, you can produce for thousands of people.
Okay.
And and if you look over the century at the return, there have been studies about the returns that you get on housing. They are very low. They are very low across the board. And there, I believe, there is a much bigger luck component than actually. A lot of my very good economist friends have lost huge sums on their housing investment. So I think their luck plays a much bigger role. These are regional shocks, and they are very hard to forecast. So the thinking is it should be actually what I call like broadly productive capital.
Okay. Well, probably a relief to many homeowners out there who've experienced large capital gains in their homes over the last couple of decades. But so interesting. Do you think, and you mentioned your own home country, Turkey. I mean, a lot of this program sounds like it might be especially attractive to emerging economies.
Absolutely.
Is there a reason to believe that's the case?
Yes, so there's this idea in economics, going back to Simon Kuznets, which is called structural transformation, that as economies develop along that development path, they move from agriculture into manufacturing, and then from manufacturing into services.
Right.
And countries like the United States, we are in the last stages of that, where we are switching out of manufacturing into services. But in many developing countries, I think they are still moving from agriculture to manufacturing. And there's a lot of evidence that the productivity of agriculture in developing countries is very low.
Right.
And so in that situation, you are going to accelerate the transition, and you can potentially improve the speed of growth in those countries.
I suppose the politics might get in the way of this in any of these economies. Do you get the feeling?
That's true. I think for whenever we talk about taxation, the economics of the problem is, you know, one issue, but the political economy is another one. I mean... Yes, there are definitely challenges there, but there are also challenges about taxing capital income.
I guess one way to address it is, of course, the people have to have an incentive to adopt these proposals. And we're speaking here about a change in one dimension of the tax code, but possibly everybody would be on board with a more efficient tax code. I mean, there are other dimensions of the tax code that could be changed at the same time, while these policies are being proposed. Does your paper speak to that at all?
Yes. So the final, if you will, the main analysis is an optimal taxation exercise. And by that, what we mean, we imagine a government that has policy tools, and these are labor income taxes, consumption taxes, and in one scenario we look at capital taxes. In the other scenario we replace capital taxes with wealth taxes. Then we say, if you are a government that has to raise a certain amount of revenues and you can choose freely among these three policy tools, how do you choose? One thing we find is when you switch from capital to wealth taxes, because it's more efficient, it actually allows you to reduce the taxation on labor.
Yeah.
Because labor taxation is quite distorting. And the way we are doing the wealth taxes, it's not. So there's an additional kick, additional benefit that comes from the ability to lower labor income taxes.
So in a representative democracy, this type of tax reform should garner a large support, one would hope.
Absolutely. So we find that in the most general case we study, about 88% of the population from all age groups and all wealth groups would be in favor of it.
Fatih, I predict a fabulous and lucrative career in consulting governments on tax policy. Sounds fascinating.
Thank you.
To conclude, can you give our audience two or three takeaways from the research here, just in bullet point form?
Sure. Yeah. So the first one is that in any modern economy, there's a lot of wealth that is allocated to individuals who are not especially good at using that. And we are proposing wealth taxes, which is an automatic way of reducing the tax burden from young, productive investors who have low wealth from typically older and wealthier investors who have low return. That's, I think, the main takeaway. And there is a global aspect to this in terms of whether this will contribute to some investors taking their wealth and go away. I don't predict that to happen too much, but I predict the opposite to happen, which is that high productivity, high wealth individuals from other countries actually might want to relocate to the United States or any other country who have wealth taxes.
Very good. Thank you, Fatih.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for taking the time to tell us about your paper.
It's my pleasure.
Enjoy the rest of the conference and St. Louis. Thank you very much.
Thank you.